Is there any set pattern to expanded consciousness or cosmic reality? If so, can you describe signs of spiritual enlightenment?
I cannot really describe it. I can only show you. Because the human language is used here to describe only human things, human life stuff like candies, apples, bananas, yeah? But it cannot describe God, because God belongs to another kind of dimension, and we have to use another kind of language, and we don't even need it. Once you see God, you see the light, then you know you are enlightened. Otherwise, the enlightened person and the non-enlightened person, anybody look alike in the physical eyes, unless like by some miracle, some grace of God, like some of the gentlemen or the ladies over there, they have seen that the enlightened person really has light around them in compared to the other people who don't have light around them. Then at least you can see, I know you are enlightened. Enlightened means you have light. You are enlightened. Yeah? There is no proof for that. Yeah? But I can prove it to you by making you enlightened. Then you know. Okay? And there is no really a written set of how you get enlightened, or else it would have been written in all the scriptures of religious doctrine of the world. There is only a silence reawakening of the God within you at the time of initiation. It's God Himself who will baptize you, who will clear the mind for a while, let the soul shine and communicate directly with God. Most of the time we are covered by the mind and the brain and all this thinking, so we can't contact directly, yeah? At the time of initiation, all this is pushed aside like a curtain. It is actually look like a curtain too to some people during initiation. Then you pierce the curtain, it rends aside, and then you see heaven, face to God. Sometimes you see moon, sun, star, heaven, Jesus, Buddha, or sometimes God make jokes like the Buddhists will see Jesus and the Christian will see Buddha, yeah. Often happen to us, it's very cute. I like that. So that our notions of religious races will fall apart. At that time he enlightened us in many different ways.
How do you know you have been to heaven?
How do I know if I have been to London?
Heaven.
Yeah. Same thing. Yeah. How do I know if I sit here? Give a lecture. Yes, you will know. You will know. Because it's your true home. You will recognize it. You have forgotten only. But once we have been there, we really never forget. Just we have forgotten. Once we are shown to it again, we know, of course. Yeah, we know.
The follow-up question to that physical level thing is, I've heard from your speeches before that there are beings in other planets in the solar system, like planets like even the moon or the Venus, yep. And their consciousness is more than the human beings.
No, this is, but you see, they are not like developing like us. You see, we are, some of us don't have as high level as them, but we are catching up with them now. And some of us are higher level than some being, and then a being in the moon or in the sun, for example.
استاد میگن ولی اونا به سریعی ما نمیتونن که تو کره زمین هستیم به اصطلاح تکامل پیدا بکنن. ما بعضیامون تو کره زمین امکان داره طبقه سوم و چهارم و طبقات بالاتر هم هستیم ولی اونجا نه دیگه بیشتر نیستن.
Because they are invisible being.
و اونها نامرئی ان.
Any invisible being or any physical being, either they're born lower level or they're born higher level. If they don't have a spiritual teacher to teach them, they stay like that.
چه کسانی که نامرئی، یعنی موجوداتی که نامرئی هستن یا معمولی هستن، اگر استاد نداشته باشن تو همون حدی که هستن میمونن. حالا میخواد طبقه سوم باشه یا چهارم باشه.
They have no problem at all, but they just don't change.
مشکلی ندارن ولی خب تکامل هم پیدا نمیکنن، تغییر نمیکنن. ولی ما انسان ها.
In this physical level, we have advantage that in the human body is quicker to progress in spiritual practice if you have a spiritual master to guide you.
ما یه مزیتی که داریم روی کره زمین، تو این دنیای فیزیک کره زمین، اینه که اگر یک استاد زنده داشته باشیم میتونیم سریع پیشرفت بکنیم و ما تغییرات رو میتونیم ببینیم.
Yes, but in this physical planet is a lot of suffering.
اما توی این کره زمین خیلی رنج و عذاب وجود داره.
In the moon, in the sun or some other planet, no.
در ماه یا خورشید یا سیارات دیگه، ستاره دیگه، این عذاب وجود نداره.
They don't know what suffering is.
نمیدونن اصلا عذاب و رنج چی.
They don't have that word in their dictionary.
حتی توی دیکشنریشون این لغت رو ندارن.
They don't even have a dictionary.
حتی دیکشنری هم ندارن.
They don't need verbal language.
احتیاج به زبان محاوره‌ای ندارن.
They enjoy peace, happiness, stability and spiritual bliss, and they enjoy telepathy.
از صلح و شادمانی و پیشرفت معنوی خودشون لذت میبرن و از تلپاتی استفاده میکنن.
In a way they are highly developed, you see, but we have the advantage of having the body and having this suffering to motivate us to practice quicker.
ما به خاطر این بدنی که داریم یه انگیزه برای ما که به خاطر درد و رنجی که میکشیم سریعتر بریم جلو.
In the moon and the sun, for example, they don't have any problem.
برای مثال توی ماه و خورشید موجودات هیچ مشکلی ندارن.
They enjoy bliss all the time.
فقط احساس خیلی شادمانی و خوبی و به اصطلاح صلح و صفا میکنن.
They don't feel the need to practice.
احتیاجی نمیبینن که هیچ ممارست و تمرینی بکنن برای پیشرفتشون.
So it's very seldom that they can jump to the fifth level. Like a human being here, we can jump to the fifth level.
خیلی به ندرته که بتونن برسن به درجه پنجم. مثل ما انسان ها که بتونیم بریم به درجه پنجم.
But what a price we have to pay here.
اما با چه قیمتی باید ما این کارو بکنیم اینجا؟
Yeah, even being a master, what a price. If they are a master on even an astral planet, they don't ever have such thing. Even just an astral planet, nobody persecute them there. And the being here, over there, even astral planet beings, they are more, how you say, sensitive to the teaching, more open, more accepting, they're more perceptive to the teaching. Anything on this physical planet is hell, it's difficult. Because we have this body. The body is a beautiful vehicle, but it's also a great hindrance. It makes all kind of trouble. It makes war within nations. It makes war within religions. It makes war between religions. It makes war between nations. It makes war between each other, between family members, between husband and wife. Just because of this physical body, it has a mind, a brain in it. And it's been programmed so in many different ways that the two programs are never alike. And so we clash with each other most of the time. And that's how we have problem on this planet, you see. But this is very good instrument also. It's like a knife with two ends, you know.
Yeah, you must believe. Your faith in yourself is the greatest healing power of any illness, of any problem that you might encounter. You must believe this, because you are the only Buddha with yourself. We are all the Buddha. But the Buddha inside knows what to do already. The soul knows what to do. If you cannot believe this, just believe the Master Power will help you. Because it would. It does help anytime. What's the use of having a Master and then the Master don't do anything for you? Huh? Even ordinary father, mother would try their best to help their children. Huh? Ordinary teacher would try their best to help their students. How would a spiritual master have access to all heaven and earth would just leave you alone in darkness and in trouble? Huh? So there is nothing we cannot solve with faith in ourselves or in the Master Power. Because actually Master Power is your power. You and I are one. So if you cannot believe in yourself, okay, let it be. Because you feel separated from the Master, fine. Then believe in the Master Power. If you really think the Master is good, then why would not the Master help you, right? And the Master Power is omnipresent. Nowhere there's a Master is not. So anywhere you call, just the Master is right there, 24 hours, remember? So everywhere you stay, everywhere you live, or whatever you face, don't panic. Just believe it will be solved. If you can solve it yourself, then try your best. If you cannot, the Master will help you. That's what the Master is there for. Until you find your own Master Power, the one who knows must help. Just like a teacher. Before you know English, he must help you to know English, see? To learn and to teach you ABC and then to repeat this sentence, that sentence, and to read all this article until you know it yourself. That's what the teacher is there for. But you also must know, learn yourself and then believe in your ability. Because you can. You can do anything you want. You are the Buddha. Never forget. Even if you cannot believe it, don't forget it. Don't forget what I told you, because what I told you is...
And you mentioned that there are different levels or inner realms. I remember watching a video. I have some of your DVDs and actually some old VHS tapes, too, from long ago that someone gave to me.
You have?
Oh, yes. I've got some of your talks. And you mentioned the different levels.
Yeah.
The different heavenly... What would be the levels?
Ah, okay. Well, for the humans, you know, that are incarnated on this planet, we can attain one of the five levels, which is in the, you know, so-called spiritual steps, spiritual consciousness. We can attain from the first to the fifth, and the fifth would be the highest for a human to attain. For example, the first one we call it astral level, the second we call it the intellectual level, the third would be the creative level, the fourth would what they call the void in Buddhism, emptiness. You will be empty of all desire and you will feel blissful there. And the fifth level is the level of the true home.
Fifth heaven is where God is.
Yes, yes. Where the highest of the manifestation of Godhead, you would call it, would be available to a mortal human to be in contact with. Above the fifth level, there are other levels, okay, James?
Right, right.
The one who descended to these physical realms have a different kind of karma, different spiritual makeup. And so when they are liberated, they could go to the fifth level, yes? And from there, they could be master of humanity, could be teacher, or they could just stay there and enjoy the blissful presence of God, the feeling of God self, the feeling of oneness with God.
Yeah.
So we can only talk up to the fifth level, all right?
Yes, indeed.
So the first level, like astral level, if we attain that level, mostly we will feel like, we have a lot of power if we attain it, okay? Suppose you and I attain the astral level, then suddenly you will feel like everything you want come easily to you. And everything you wish suddenly will appear somewhere. Or you have a power to change the situation by mere wish, because the astral level is a magical power level. But that is not the ultimate, of course. And then the second level, if we attain it, then we have a lot of intellectual power. We have eloquence. We will never be defeated in any arguments. We will be always the winner. We have such a tremendous power of conviction and in speech, that anyone hears us would feel like, oh, we are right. And we will have victories all the time in any debate, for example. And we can also, by the way, see in our past and perhaps our future as well, because we can have access to the Akashic record, which is in the second level.
Right.
Now, on the third level, we will have a lot of creative power. A lot of things, ideas, you know, projects to come to us easily, if we but have time to realize them. Would be a lot of ideas coming, a lot of talents come out, a lot of abilities. Anything you never thought you have would come to you. And the fourth level, you'll be more calm, more gentle, very peaceful in demeanor and thinking and manner. Every day you feel life is easy and good, and you feel loving and kind. And the fifth level, that is the level of the truth, of the Master. And you will realize much aspect of God which scripture cannot describe and which you also cannot describe.
Right, beyond words, beyond form,
yes.
Beyond the physical.
Yes, but then we don't have that much of the eloquence anymore. We pass that stage. So sometimes you find that if you're on the fifth level and people accuse you of something and you know you haven't done it, and you know it's wrong, and you know their concept is wrong, but it doesn't come to you quickly to answer them or to defeat them, like when you were in the second or almost third level or something like that. So in China, there is a saying that the wisest man seems like the most stupid.
Maybe. Yes. And the Tao that can be named is not the real Tao?
Yeah. Maybe that saying came from one of the realization of the ancient sages. And it is true like that. It is different. And then you will wonder, how come a few years ago I was so quick and sharp-witted? I can always defend myself. I can always win in any argument. And now suddenly I'm like speechless or dumbfounded in many situations. I look like I regress in spiritual practice. But it's not like that. You just get over one of your stage.
Just more within yourself.
Yeah.
Yes, I know some writings of mystics that are like that, that are kind of unintelligible or in a different language almost, you know, just hard to read, hard to understand.
Yeah.
You're just in a different place, a different state.
Right. Once upon a time, long time ago. Yes. There was a small town that has two parallel streets, you know? One on the left and one on the right. Two streets like this. They're opposing each other. And now, a dervish, you remember already? Muslim? Mm-hmm. And he happened to pass by this town. So first he went on to one street and then he walked to another street because they're parallel. You go to one street first and then you walk to another street. When he reached the second street, some people have noticed that his eyes were full of tears and they're running down. You know, tears will keep running down. So suddenly somebody cried out and said, "Oh! Somebody died on the first street," because he saw the devil coming from the first street, eyes streaming with tears. So someone on the second street said, "Oh, somebody died on the first street." He presumed, he thought that somebody had died. Okay. And then all the children nearby heard that, and they also joined in and said, "Oh, somebody died on the first street." And then they're all running back to their respective houses and saying the news, "Oh, somebody died on the first street," just like that. But they didn't even ask the dervish why his eyes were streaming. Can you guess why? One candy. Why?
It was windy.
Perhaps, yes, it could be possible, yes. Some people, when it's windy, their eyes streaming with tears. Or dirt, you know, anything. What else can it be?
It's karma.
It's such a karma. My God. So serious.
He's happy?
He may be happy. Yeah, it could be. You know when you're happy, you cry, right?
Yeah.
Possible. Yeah. What else can it be?
Any cook around here? Chef?
Spicy, onion.
Onion, yeah. But I gave you already a hint. That's why. He was peeling onions before he went out. He probably was peeling onion, and maybe he was short of soy sauce. So he ran out to the next street in order to buy some soy sauce to cook for the Supreme Master Television. Who knows? Yeah, so, in any case, that's what it was. He was peeling onions. And then he ran out to the second street, because probably the second street they have some shops which sells things that he needs, which did not have on the first street. Well, anyway, it doesn't explain here, but we could guess. He saw the dervish, he ran out to the second street with his eyes streaming with tears. And now, after a short time, all this screaming about somebody die on the first street reached every corner of the town. And everybody joined in. They were so upset and distressed and very confused. Because this is a very small town, and only two streets, and everybody knows everybody here. And almost like everybody is related to everybody in this small town. It's like a small family. So they all worry so much. Who could be the one that is dying on the first street? Could it be my cousin? Could it be my uncle? Could it be my aunt? Could it be my, you know, sister or brother or in-law or whatever? Yeah, everybody was stressed. And in those days, they did not have telephone. Yeah, so they could not even call each other so fast to call whether you're okay. They're just telling each other somebody died on the first street. That's it. And everybody was stressed out. And then nobody even dared to make an inquiry to who was dying and why. Why is it so much a commotion? Nobody asked because they're all so busy, stressed out, listening to each other. Yes, somebody died, and then they were busy. Go tell the other one. Somebody died on the street, and that person busy. Go to tell the other one. And the whole town was full of news about this dying person. Nobody inquired about who died and why. And in town, there was a wise man, and he was telling everybody, please calm down, at least go ask, you know, why didn't you ask who died first and why? And then everybody was so, very, very stressed and confused, and they all talked at the same time, and nobody listened to nobody, and very, very noisy and chaotic, and say, all we know is just there is a deadly plague on the other street. First somebody was dying, and now there is an infectious disease going on the next street. A deadly plague is going on.
Oh, my God.
As soon as they spoke and thus, this rumor fly all over direction again, and everybody now knew that there's a plague, deadly disease on the first street. Then everybody, the whole population of town, thinking that's it, this is the end of the world, as predicted somewhere. Finito, you know, plague, you know, infectious. Oh, we are doomed. And they all start crying a lot. First they cry for the dead person, and now they're crying for themselves and the doomed future that they're waiting. And then after a long time, after all the care and all the crying somehow died out a little bit, and a little bit order was restored. And then two communities decided that, okay, they should talk to each other. Finally. They have not even asked nothing yet. They decided that we have to talk to each other and move the leftover person to the other community quickly before they all die of the plague. You know, that's what they think. So they begin packing belongings and calling children and calling cow cart, horse carriage, whatever, you know. Yeah. And then, in no time, from both of the streets, the whole population was evacuated. The title says this is how a tradition was found, you know. The founding of a tradition. So now, decades later, the two streets, the town is still deserted. Nobody lived there anymore. Mm. And not so far away, the two villages. That's probably born out of this plaque, you know. Yes. Each village has its own tradition of how it began as a settlement from a doomed town. Yes. Through a fortunate flight in remote times from a nameless evil. They all tell their story and tradition, how they found the villages. You see, this is one of the teachings found in the book of the teaching of the secret recluse in long-time Muslim tradition. They just want to illustrate that people are so ignorant that they don't even bother to find out what caused what. Yes, it's very difficult to reason to them. Once they set their mind on something, I even listen to false rumor, they still believe it. And then not just one person, but the whole town evacuated. The blind lead the blind, you know? They are going away like that. And that's how a tradition has been found. Just like many, perhaps, other traditions. That's what the master wanted to tell us in this story. This teaching was from Sheikh Kalanda Shah of the Surawali order. He died in 1832, not long ago, eh? Might be a century ago. He still has a shrine as Lahore, Pakistan. Maybe it's not a true story, but the master was a true person and was existing at that time. Not long ago, eh? Yeah. Can you imagine? Mm. The blind lead the blind, eh? Mm. And both go wherever. So, in this teaching, Sheikh wants to tell us that we have to be discriminating. Eh? We have to use our discriminating mind to discern what is the truth and what is not. We cannot just hear from saying, you know, in such a matter like even moving the whole town. It's possible that this is a true story, you know? It's possible like that. Yes, because the rumor is getting bigger and bigger all the time. And people just listen and then they add their own imagination and the next person adds some more imagination, then it becomes very great, a disaster, and everybody moves just like that. Similar to many belief systems. People just believe anything without proof, eh? Yes. Without proof. Without checking. Like, okay, God is light, but nobody see any light. Nobody see God. God is love. We don't feel any love for Him, because we don't even know God. For example, like that, yeah? So even though there are a lot of evidence in the Bible, Buddhist scripture, saying that Buddha has light around them, for example, huh? And Buddha nature is in you, God is in you, and Buddha nature we know is light, huh? And nobody see nothing. Just listening, and then just continue whatever tradition that you happen to chance upon. And I said, the blind lead the blind, and then, you know, forever it's like that. And when somebody come along and say, I tell you what, I show you what you were reading there, and they would think, it's not possible. In my tradition, there's no such thing. The tradition has been passed on ever since. My great-great-great-grandfather, it cannot be wrong. And you just came along today and you say, you can prove it? No, not possible. Yeah? It's like that. It's a sad story, huh? Sad affair. But it is true in this.
The light and the sounds are there sometimes to assure you that you are going okay, you're going in the right direction. And whenever the light is very intense and the sound is very, very clear, that means you enter deep into the higher consciousness. When the sound is faint or the light is dim, that means you are just at the border of higher intelligence, okay? So these are the measurement for you to know yourself, how far you have advanced. Not that for anyone to really judge you whether you are higher Buddha or you are lower Bodhisattva. This is no nonsense like this. We are all going home. Yeah? Somebody goes slower, somebody goes faster, just like here. Yeah? If you are very hungry, then you run fast to the kitchen. If you just eat some biscuits in the tent, then you go slower, huh? Or if your legs are longer, you walk faster, huh? The Asian people have a shorter leg, walk very slow. That's why we have become snail family. Last time, huh? We have bestowed upon ourselves all the titles, golden snail, silver snail, all kind of snails, stainless steel snails, ordinary snail, yeah? Okay. Only the light and the sound can help us in any kind of situation in this world, and solve for us any kind of karma, any kind of bad burden from past, present or future. There's nothing else in this world that we can rely on. These, the light and the sound, are the only method, are the only equipment that God has bestowed upon us when we descend into this world, so that we can protect ourselves, so that we can remember the kingdom of God, so that we can dissolve any difficulty and obstruction on our way of finding the kingdom of God. But we are
all movie stars. This world is a super stage, and we are superstars. We play many roles, life after life, in perfection. Sometimes we play angels, sometimes we play human, sometimes we play husband, sometimes we play wife, kings, ministers, queens, and sometimes we play some undesirable roles. But the thing is, we play all these roles unknowingly, unconsciously. So often we ask ourselves, why? Why do I have to play this role? Why do I have to act this way? Why someone else is on the throne, and why I'm just a laborer or just a secretary, etc. To the knowing souls, the world is only a stage, and we learn various roles in order to learn and to fulfill our desire and our needs to grow into perfection. Now we often hear that God or Buddha is very merciful, is all-knowing and all-perfect, almighty, omnipresent. So why doesn't he know what we need? Why doesn't he make us perfect automatically? Why does he send us here that we have to struggle and learn all this very difficult and seems very suffering lessons? The reason is, well, according to my own enlightenment, there isn't that much suffering. It is all play. And everything lasts very quickly in eternity. Lasts like a fraction of a second only. Therefore, in God's or Buddha's eyes, there's no actually much and long and enduring suffering. It's only in our eyes, in our own limited understanding and time and space, that we perceive them so.
Everybody is liberated according to all the enlightened masters, because the enlightened masters are liberated. Therefore, they can see it from a liberated point of view, because they know that all the bad karmas, all the obstacles, all the illusionary burdens and bondage that we, the ordinary human being, feel is only nonsense. It's only dreaming a state. There's non-existent at all. We have never been even born. We have never committed anything wrong. It's all because we wander into the illusionary maze. Therefore, we believe that we are in trouble. The more we try to get out of it, the more we make more trouble. But actually, we originally should not be there, in the maze. That's it. And we forgot everything about the previous connection before we lost into that maze. Therefore, from the one who stay outside of this illusion, he knows that originally you're not like that, and you make trouble, you cause trouble, and you are in trouble just because you have been lost in that maze, you've been thrown in that maze, or somehow you wander into that illusionary maze that caused a lot of trouble for you now. And all the trouble that you made while trying to distangle yourself from the maze or try to escape from that is forgivable, is understandable, and is originally illusionary anyhow. The maze is only a game inside. So whatever you did inside, it's only a kind of game. And anyhow, you were cheated into it. You don't know anything about it. You just try to get out. It is the system of the maze to make you make more trouble and make you difficult to get out. So everything you committed inside there is non-existent, right? No sin, no crime. And it is very natural. Only the one who tried to help you out understand all this. And you don't need to seek even forgiveness because you have not done anything wrong. If somebody throw you into that maze with all things appear in hallucination and all cheating or nothing that is real, only making trouble for you, then how can you are blamed for whatever you do to get out of that? And even if you killed or you do anything inside, it's only because you're forced to. And also the maze is illusionary anyhow. So that's it. It's just like when we went into a kind of Disneyland. In America, there is a place called Disneyland. Inside there appear all kind of huge animals and huge persons and all that because of the movies. So sometimes when you visit there, you feel like you were in some kind of a distant past. And all that animals are very fierce. From their mouths comes out the fire and all that kind of destruction, yeah? But this is all game. If you don't know about this, you're frightened and nobody explained it to you and you think it's real. And you might try to get out of that place and you might damage some of these animals. But these animals are not real anyhow. So you didn't kill anything. It can be replaced any time. For you have not done anything wrong at all, according to my view. According to what I have studied from other masters in the past and present. But it's difficult to convince most of the people about this point of view. Because when they're lost inside this game, they don't remember the reality. It's difficult to remember. Therefore, we must use some kind of power to awaken their memory about their real self. That is a method. Guanyin method. Just, and then you remember. At least something. At least you're half awake yet, and then you can slowly recover the whole consciousness. So that's why we say we are all originally pure Buddha liberated.
Please, I would like to know why the practice is light and sound, why this is the best to get enlightened.
Because it is the best. No explanation.
You can't explain a little more? But
no, the more I explain, the more it sounds garbage to me. Actually, you know, how can you explain the sun? You know, it just is. Mm-hmm. And because it's ourselves. The light and the sound are our essence. You understand? You go back to yourself. What else could you feel better if you are yourself? What else can make the fish feel better if he's in the water? Huh? Why he feels better in the water?
Because he's a fish.
Well, ask me to explain. I don't know. Okay?
Okay.
Yes. Yeah. And if you feel good, that's you know already.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
It's only the best. That's all I know. Yeah?
Okay.
And if you look for reference, we can see it in the Bible. Yeah? Right. St. John hears the trumpet, you know, and God comes with the voice of the thunder. You know, in the beginning was the Word. From the Word comes our being. Yeah? The sound. So if we are in our element, it must be the best, don't you think? Yeah. That's what it is. In the Buddhist Sutra, I say the same thing. In the Quran, wherever you find it, always mention light and sound. This is the essence of our being. And now you know, scientifically speaking, we are light and sound. We are energy. So what else can it make us feel the best if it's not ourselves? You know? Go back into our elements. Realizing ourselves. Yeah? That's the best. That's all it is. Okay?
So it's seeing our own light and hearing our own sound.
Yeah.
Actually.
Oh, seeing yourself. Yourself, yes.
Thanks.
Not your own light, but you are the light. Not your own sound, but you are the sound. You are the vibration that creates the whole universe. You are that. You are the commander-in-chief of this cosmos. The more you realize that you are that, the more power you have, the more free you become. Instead of realizing that you are this flesh, you are this fingernail, you are this and that, you realize that no, I am the creator, I am the light, I am the sound, I am that absolute thing. Okay?
Okay.
All right.
When you die, the soul is free. Is this a soul that carries the karma from life to life? What carries the karma from life to life?
It is the mind. It is the alaya. It is the power of memories.
That is in the soul?
No, it's not in the soul. It's a kind of energy force. When you do something, it generates some energy. And that energy forms a certain formula or certain conception or certain form, however invisible to the physical eyes. And these energies, these formulas stick together and make a kind of pattern, okay? And through this pattern, the soul experiences up and down, bad and good in this world. And after a long period, the soul identifies itself with this kind of pattern, instead of realizing it is free from that pattern. Just like after you work too much with a computer, you get stick to it, and maybe you forgot yourself, you forgot to eat, you forgot to sleep. You just stick yourself with the computer, and then the computer go wrong, the computer make a mistake and you get angry. And then sometimes you blame yourself for the mistakes. And then you get trouble with the mistake and you correct the mistake and you have fixed it and you have so much trouble and anger with the computer, yeah? And you stick to that all the time, past your lunch time and all that because of the mistakes. And you completely forgot all the duty and that your wife's waiting, that you are Mr. such and such. And you're free, you don't need to stick there, yeah? And now the pattern of the past and the formula of the past will form kind of a solid but invisible force, yeah? And the soul will see through it, and then it kind of attach with it. And if you don't have a kind of wisdom to detach yourself with the informations that you have gathered through lives after life, then you are in trouble. You identify yourself with trouble. You always try to solve the troubles, and then you always entangle in troubles. And that's how the soul is not free from troubles. And after we die, the soul stick itself with the troubles and try to solve the troubles again in the next body, in the next opportunity. Therefore, we reincarnate and reincarnate and reincarnate. Only when we realize that the troubles are trouble, we can always throw it away and we don't need to solve it. And throw everything all together in a dustbin and just do what the necessary leftover that is still attached to our soul and then get rid of them and then free.
Does that have anything to do with the level that we reach?
Sure, yes. sure. Most of the people who do not practice, they are at human level. Just get bound with the problems, with the habits from many lives. And they think they have to take care of all this, and they have to solve all this problem. If they couldn't solve in this life, they come back the next. And when they came back the next life, they have a new problem. And the old problems has not been solved. The new problem has already developed. So they always envelop themselves and entangle in this kind of mess, and can never get out until the master come and point the way invisibly to them and say, this way you must go and leave all that garbage there. Without you, nobody die. Without all this problem, you don't die. This problem is self-created. You just throw all the bundle in the dustbin and that's done with, and go with me. Then the soul begin to realize what a mistake, what a waste of time he has been sticking in the mud all the time. So now he get up. Yeah. Begin a new life. Okay.
At the time of initiation, whatever karma you had in the store, done. Okay? You're free, free soul. But you had a little bit of karma left so that you can exist on this planet or until you're gone. You see what I mean? That bad karma we cannot erase. Because if we erase, you die. You die before you reach the third level or second level or fourth level. You see what I mean? So the purpose of leaving little karma here to endure a little so that you have time to go up to the fifth, the fourth, yeah? Understand me?
All yes. Right.
Now, but we can not erase, but like minimize the bad karma. I told you already, at the time of initiation, like, for example, you're supposed to have a very bad accident. You have it in a dream, yes? Or you have a smaller accident, yes? You have accident, for example, but you're not injured too much. You see what I mean? Or you recover very fast and doctor surprise, for example, like that. Okay? Yes. But if completely erase this fixed karma for your lifetime, then you have to go immediately. I mean, goodbye. So you stay for a while to rise your level. Because to practice in this world is very good, very fast, very meritorious. Okay?
Thank you
better,
very much.
Better
Thank
than you. Other planet or other level of consciousness. Okay?
Thank you.
You know why? Because, for example, if you go even to astral level only, yeah? Remember many people who die like clinically dead and they came back and they tell how nice and beautiful heaven, similar to here but more beautiful. And people become young even though when they die they were old, or for example. This is just astral level. And they love so much that they don't want to come back here. And when they come here, they cry and cry and cry. You see what I mean? So, for example, if you are in that astral level, you're so happy already, you don't want to meditate nada. See what I mean? There's no motivation, no pushing force behind your meditation. Here you sometimes you feel fed up with family, you heartbroken because of love affair, or you see people suffer, animals suffer, and your heart touch, you know? And you wish to do something to erase your sorrow, not just from yourself, but from the things that you see around you, you see? Or to give them some comfort by your spiritual wish, blessing wish, you see what I mean? So that is the motivation to do it. In heaven, everybody's so happy. You can't even remember what day it is, and, you know, you're just too busy enjoying. There's nothing to remind you of why you have to go anywhere else. You see what I mean? But astral level is not long-lasting. See? They don't know that. Well, even they know, they don't care. See how we suffer in this world, but nobody care about thinking of the future, huh? See what I mean? Huh? Yeah. Even then, if you are happy in the astral level, for example, you don't want to practice nothing. Very difficult to practice there. You think in this world it's difficult to practice because you're busy, because of so much sorrow. You should go heaven at astral level and you see how more difficult it is. Because there's no point, you know, like no motive. yeah, to do that. Okay. Because we are children of God, you know. The experience that you had in childhood, that is the kind of enlightenment, the moment of awakening. But then you forget that, then you have to renew it again and again. Or else we suffer the illusion of being lesser than children of God. So we have to remind each other, us again, because every day we spend about 20 hours, 18 hours in the world, where everybody else, the whole society, friend, relative, reminding us that we are a mere human mortal. You know what I mean? That we're weak, we're physical, we are nothing. So we have to spend at least 2.5 hours, you know, 1/10 of our time, to remind ourselves that no, no, I'm God. I'm God's child. I'm spiritual being. I'm great. Understand? That's the time we spend to remind ourselves, to counteract the world pressure, that don't let them convince us that we are just a mere human, weak being. You understand? So that's why we have to meditate every day, or else once initiation enough, you're Buddha, finished. Yeah, final.
Master, some people think that they don't need to meditate because they think they don't need it, or they think that they're high enough. Could this be true in some cases?
No, because you never know how much is enough. Okay? Yes.
Oh,
and
yes,
maybe,
Master.
Maybe your life is comfortable and your material existence is simple, and so you think you have enough, but that is almost like ego talk, yes? No one really had enough meditation in this world and know it, okay? That's one thing. Another thing, even if you know that you have enough merit, that you don't meditate anymore, enough for what? Huh? Okay, so you just go to, suppose you have enough merit to go to the fifth level. That's it? It's all about you? How about other beings on this planet? How about all suffering people? You have to meditate even if you have enough, even if you know you have enough, which you don't never know. There's never such thing as enough, okay? You can meditate more so that you can help other people. You can bless this world, which you own so much. You're born into this world with nothing. And you've been fed, you've been clothed, you've been loved, you've been blessed until you grow up. How much favor, how much love you own to everyone around you in this world. The one who make your clothes, the one who grow vegetable, the one who, you know, who plow the field in sweat and tears and under the sun, in the cold climate, in the freezing weather, just to keep you alive. How much you owe them? You have to meditate more. Even, suppose you even say that you know you have enough. What enough is enough? Never, okay? I meditate not because of myself. Enough or not, I meditate so that everyone else can benefit. However much or little I can give.
Many guys, many people who die and then has not enough merit to be born as human again immediately or to be born in heaven. So they were in hell for a while, so-called hell, ne? They'd be punished or doing something terrible to them to clean out their karma, burn out all the bad things, cut out all the morally also from their soul, so they are supposed to be born again. So the king of hell would give them an audience and ask them what is it that they want now, in which kind of position they want, and what kind of life they want to lead, as now they are having the privilege to be born as human again. So anyhow, one by one, they'll answer, yeah? Some of them will say, oh, I'm so happy to get to be free of hell now that I'm sure I'm going to be human being and very honored and very happy and I'm going to be a good person. And for example, I want to serve, I want to do this. Okay, then they give you a good position. Like being a nurse or doctor or whatever, in a serving position to give them a good chance to serve people. Okay, good.
And another person said, oh, since I have been in hell very long, I'm very terrible, miserable now. I want to enjoy life. I want to have a beautiful surrounding, you know, and beautiful clothes and a lovely voice so that I can sing and charm all the females, you know, and things like that. And I should have a beautiful abode next to a river, yeah, and should have plentiful food that I don't have to go and earn money and to take it. Okay? So anyhow, the king of hell say, all right. So he told his subordinate, the devils, to bring him exactly what he need. So what did they brought him? A feather. Beautiful bird. You know, beautiful bird. So shining feather. Yeah, that's what he want. He want beautiful clothes. No need to earn it. Understand? So he had it fixed permanently. No need to wash it even. No trouble. He doesn't want a trouble life. He wants just sit there eating and drinking. And singing even. So he gives him a big, beautiful feather body and then a nice voice. So he can sing all day long. And then place him next to a stream in the forest. Now there are lots of berries, wild fruit, and beautiful surrounding, and he has drinking, eating, and beautiful feather. Nothing to worry about. That's what they give him. Exactly according to what he wants. So do not blame God for our position. It is what we wanted. Now another guy came up also from hell and wanted also a similar thing. Like, oh, I have always been burned in hell, and all my flesh look like it's all gone. I'm skinny and bony now. I want to get fat to get even, you know. Fat people, fat look very, how say, have very, a lot of blessing to be fat, you know. Most of people think to be fat and big is a kind of meritorious life. I want that. I just want to have a lot of food to eat every day. And people bring food right to my door, right to my mouth, that I don't even have to move. I have been so hard life in hell. I want to make up for it now. I want to just eat and drink and sleep and get fat. Yes. I have been very skinny up till now because all the fire in hell draw my blood out, burn all my fat and all my flesh now. I want to get fat. I want to eat and drink, and people have to serve me, you know. I want people to serve me, bring food up to my door, up to my mouth even. I don't have to go anywhere. I don't have to earn money for it. Give me that kind of life, okay? Then I don't have to worry about food, clothing, and everybody's servant, and okay. So the king tell his subordinate to bring his outfit for this life. You know what is that? A pig skin. Okay, put it on for him, and then he immediately became a pig. And after that, he drank a kind of liquid, and he forgot everything about his past life, and he just enjoyed to be a pig. And there he has everyday people bring food up to his mouth, and wash him, bath him, bring drinking for him, you know, and make him fat. And he has to do nothing at all. So that's the kind of life that he wanted. So he got it. Otherwise, how can you have a human life and you have to do nothing, no responsibility, and you get food and drink, bring it to your mouth without doing anything? Do you think there is a human life like that? No. So, they have to give him a pig's life to satisfy his desire. And this is very justified. Because according to what you want, your father give you. Is that not so? Huh? Whatever you knock and it shall be given, ask and knock and it shall be open, ask and it shall be given. So if you ask for the impossible thing, you get the impossible life. And that's what it is. That's how many people run into trouble and be born into lower level of consciousness just because of the misconception. Just because they want things for nothing. Just because they want to go against the law of karma here in this world. Once we are above the law of karma, then it's okay. We're in heaven, we're in nirvana, then whatever we want it will be supply. Yeah? We don't even need to want. But when we are in the three world here still, with the physical body, physical needs, physical demands, and we have to make also physical contribution. That's why in the Bible say, with the sweat of your brow you earn your bread. No other way. We have been in Eden, we have been in heaven, but we forsook it. Now we're in this world, we have to obey the law. Take care of yourself and your business. Doesn't mean freedom that you fly in the sky. I stay here and open the mouth and waiting for the berries to come. Freedom means you have a great responsibility. Means nobody should have to tell you what to do, but you know what to do. That is when you have freedom. You have freedom by choice. If you know everything, what to do, and take care of your life and your work, then you have freedom. No way before. If you still let people tell you what to do, because you don't know what to do yourself, then you are not free. Doesn't matter how much you want to be free, you are not. Because you're bound within your own ignorance. Understand? You let your mind cheat you. Cheat you into thinking you're free and you're okay when you're not. So there is much work to do for ourselves. And as I said already, your level is up to you. Even if I take you to the fifth and you're not up to it, you're still on the first. Yeah? Even I am university professor, but you are still in a kindergarten state. If I take you to the college by my own power and position, what do you do there? Understand? You cannot do anything. You don't understand. Even I love you very much, but I cannot help you to be intelligent in such age. So it's up to you. Try to polish your own power, manner, and the way of life. You have to know. You can choose. You can choose whatever you want. But then, do not blame anyone. If you're not free, if you're not progressed, and if you're not respected, or if, you know, you're no good for yourself. That's all. Otherwise, it doesn't concern anyone. What kind of life, what kind of level you choose to be in.